I'd like to welcome you to the fourth edition of the Global Indian Realty Summit in Hyderabad. Thank you for taking the time, and we are very excited to be here this evening. We have some of the stalwarts of the real estate sector here today. I'd just like to rewind and take a minute to talk about the premise and how, you know, GIRS came into existence. Obviously, we are a media powerhouse. We have interest across television, publishing, as well as digital properties. And our aim as a media house has always been to add value to the audience, be it through the various channels that we have or through events such as these. We wanted to bring real estate experts, subject matter experts, to have interaction with real estate industry professionals, real estate retail investor base, HNIs, and to be able to have a much more interactive understanding of all the changes that are happening in the sector. With the advent of all the regulatory changes, and especially in the state of Telangana, with the shift in the political setup as well, the whole sector has been witnessing a very positive change. And we hope that this evening, you will have the chance to take away a lot of insights about the regulatory changes, as well as an understanding about what to expect from the markets, both current as well as, you know, how, what to anticipate of the future of this industry. Again, special thank you to the audience, special thank you to all the guests who have, you know, taken, flown from different places to be here amongst us. And our curator and moderator, Ms. Manisha, has also been very important to put this together. She's been instrumental in getting stalwarts onto this panel. Without any further ado, I would request Mr. Nagu Chindabram, who is the MD of St. Angelo's VNCT Ventures, to please say a few words. Thank you, and hope you enjoy.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It gives me great pleasure in welcoming you all to the fourth edition of the Global Indian Realty Summit, the first for Hyderabad. We launched this in Dubai first, and this is a property that's a knowledge platform that's presented to you by Network 18 in collaboration with us, St. Angelo's VNCT Ventures. The first was in Dubai, and then we followed it up by having the next in Chennai and then in Mumbai, and here we are for the fourth event. To quickly tell you, of course, you just heard what this platform is all about. So basically, we're here to try and bring about all the facts of the reality sector, what's happening, and how the trend is moving. And when we have people like Manisha, you can only expect the best. So that's the way it's going. And thank you very much for being here. For me to quickly tell you what St. Angelo's VNCT Ventures is all about. We are global developers. We have our developments happening in Dubai and in India. And in India, we do our developments in Mumbai, Chennai, Coimbatore, Madurai, and today we're happy to announce that we launched our project in Hyderabad, Jatcherla. And we come under the brand, or the product is called as the White House or the White Villas. And we're into this segment called affordable luxury. Contradicting as it might sound, and it is for a fact, affordable on the price and luxurious on the product quality and the way it's being created. And we're very passionate about it. My partner, Mr. Agnello Rajesh, and me are very, very passionate, and we go after giving the best. And as he had just said about an hour ago, we try and see how we can be better than what we were in our earlier projects. So basically, we're trying to compete with our own selves to offer the best to the client, because client is king. Thank you very much for being here once again, and this is going to be a lovely evening. Wish you all a lovely evening once again. Sorry, I messed up a little bit. Let me invite Mr. Venkateshwaralu, President, Telangana Chamber of Commerce and Industry. So this happens in GIRS. Last time I was missed out. Please come over.
I thank Network 18 for having given us this wonderful opportunity, which is now taking place in the state, which is really happening. And the whole country, now Telangana state, has got its own importance, its own significance. It has now emerged as number one in easing of doing business in the country. When the state was formed, it was number 13. Subsequently, it reached number 2. Today, it is number 1. We have taken all revolutionary measures to see that the state becomes a golden Telangana state. And I'm happy to get associated with Network 18 group. And I assure the Telangana Chamber of Commerce Industry will always be at their beck and call in organizing more and more events in Hyderabad. Coming to the activities of Telangana, I would like to just brief you. This was established in 2010 with a membership strength of about, the present strength is about 3,200 members with small scale, medium and major industries in, across Telangana state. We have taken up many important projects like converting Hyderabad into a solar city. It is in the process now. Hyderabad is being converted. We have signed an agreement with Gujarat government for organizing the conversion of Hyderabad. And I think most probably in the next 1 year, the Hyderabad will become a solar city. And the first time in the history of the state, not only in the history of state, in the history of the country, we are generating power through floating solar panels. This is, we have taken up as a pilot plant. And first thing is, we will be, if everything goes well, we will be generating about 350 megawatt power per day. So this is an this is very important, useful, this thing. And other states are also becoming, are also following our procedures to see that they're all after their state governments to commence these projects. In fact, the model is taken from the government of Gujarat. Our Honorable Prime Minister, when he was the Chief Minister, he initiated this project and he set an example for this. And the other thing is the small scale industries in the MSME sector, they have been fighting a losing battle for decades together. Even in Telangana state, we have got about 4,500 units which have become sick when the state government came into power, the TRS government came into power. And the whole issue was reviewed by the young Minister of State, Mr. K.T. Rama Rao, and he has designed a policy, industrial health clinic. They have released 100 crores recently. And Telangana Chamber of Commerce has entered into an MOU with the Nalsar University, which is number one in the country, with their Institute of Economic Excellence and Economics. What we are doing is, in the, every nook and corner of the state, wherever there is a possibility for establishing a small-scale industry, we are preparing a report. And wherever the industry has gone sick, we are probing into the FIRs why it became sick, and we are trying to rectify them. That is one of the reasons why we have set an, we have signed an MOU with Nalsar University. And the whole report is under preparation. Most probably by 31st October, we'll be submitting a report to the government. And about the MSME sector also, Reserve Bank of India has been making many attempts to see that the units in the small sectors become very viable, but they're not, in spite of Reserve Bank of India's instructions also, things are not improving. Ultimately, what we have decided is to hold a conference of all the state chambers of commerce industry in Hyderabad. We'll be hosting a conference. And this initiative is taken by the Telangana Chamber of Commerce, which is appreciated by the different states. And the first state which came forward is Gujarat. We have requested the Honorable Prime Minister to inaugurate this. Most probably, in fact, it was to take place when Jayalalitha died, the Chief Minister of Tamil Nadu. Otherwise, it should have taken place. And now we are expecting this conference to take place sometime in October, last week or first week of November. Most probably, this may be clubbed with the visit of the daughter of the American president. She is visiting Hyderabad. The whole industrial policies will be reviewed. Telangana Chamber of Commerce has got a role to play in that. And all the 29 state chambers of commerce will have a say into that. It is going to be a two-day conference. And I'm sure this conference, after due discussions and deliberations, will bear fruitful results, and there may be some relief in the small-scale sector. So now, anyway, I'm very happy to get associated with this. In fact, this invitation came to me when some NRIs have been asking me for the last few months to hold a conference in Hyderabad to apprise them of the implications of the prosperity and the opportunities in the real estate sector. So when I was trying to probe into that, when I was trying to make a report on that with eminent persons like Mr. Ram Reddy, I don't know whether Ram Reddy Gar is here. He has not come. So when I was about to prepare a report, this invitation came and I took it as an opportunity. We will be shortly holding a conference of real estate developers associations very soon on behalf of Telangana Chamber of Commerce Industry and ascertain their views, and we'll be establishing a separate cell for NRIs who are interested to make. So many people are coming for. Even last evening also, one gentleman came to me from Canada. He has got some money to make investments in real estate. Then I asked him to attend the seminar. At any moment, he may land up now. So this is the status of real estate. The only thing is, people are not aware of the facilities. People are not aware of, they do not have appropriate education in improving the sector. So I request all of you, I will collect the data from Network 18. I will send the invitations to everybody. We'll hold a very big conference on sometime just before the Prime Minister's visit. And if it is necessary, if there is any amount of opportunity, we'll club this conference with the Prime Minister's visit. So Tech is always at the disposal of Network 18. And I'm very happy the way this is organized, especially Sudha, Lakshmi, that the way they have been, Sudha Sharma. So the way they have been pursuing the matter is excellent. And Techie, once again, I assure that Techie will have its own role to play with Networking 18. And the other thing is, Telangana Chamber of Commerce is establishing a separate committee for real estate. There was a committee, but it is not up to the mark, and we are reviewing the performance, and we're reappointing the members on the review committee, and we'll be appointing a chairman for the real estate committee also. By any chance, if any one of you who are staying in Hyderabad, if you want to get associated with the real estate committee, they are most welcome. In fact, we need a strong person to head the real estate committee. If anybody is there, I'll be welcoming them. I'll be with them, and you can always be assured of Techie's cooperation in whatever way you want, and we are for the prosperity of the real estate. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Good evening, everybody, and thank you so much, sir, for those inspiring words. Medium and small scale sector across the country can do with a lot of leg up. It is the largest job creator, but right now that sector is under duress. Looking forward to that conference, and of course for your partnership, you could partner with us again and we'd be happy to come back to your state. Hyderabad is a lovely city. Right after marriage, I moved here, and my first 2 years of a little TVS red scooty and my husband on a Bajaj scooty and couple of three or four people, there were no rules that time. We didn't have to wear helmets and we used to go to outdoor areas and, you know, literally the borders of Hyderabad to get little tippled, because we also went through a dry phase in Hyderabad at that time. So fantastic memories of Hyderabad, always been a very city which has been very close to my heart, so quite happy to be back here. Again, of course, just to give you a little introduction, people who don't know what I do, I actually look at real estate and urban development for Network 18 portfolio. My parent channel is CNBC TV 18, and we have two shows on that channel. There's Urban Reality, which actually looks at large issues of urbanization and cities in you and renovation of cities, the whole rejuvenation process that the government is aiming for and actually pushing for. We also have a home buyer show called The First Time Home Buyer, because that's where the market has moved. Investors have left the market, and for the right reason, prices have moderated. And there's a new norm in real estate. So much has happened in the last 6 months that everybody is trying to find their feet on shifting ground, whether it's developers or it's home buyers or policymakers. Everyone's getting slammed. But obviously, all this chaos is happening for a new fantastic norm to actually happen or appear. Let me call my first round of panelists. We're going to discuss something which is very obvious, but something which has huge excitement and interest, which is RERA and GST. Every morning if I start and I just have to post anything on RERA on Twitter, and there's automatically about 100 retweets and, you know, about another 40, 50 comments around that. As soon as people got to know that I was coming to Hyderabad, Fight for RERA group contacted me and they dragged me, and I've just done a discussion with them as well, and you know, we will play that out. So RERA and GST both are important issues, and I've got really, honestly, I couldn't have asked for a better panel, and I've got three people who are just probably the dream panel to have. Anuj Puri, Chairman, Anarock Property. Of course, everybody knows Anuj Puri, so no introductions needed. Anuj has flown in specially for our panel discussion. Thank you very much. Really appreciate it. This chair. Also with us, Anand Reddy, ED of PBEL Property Developer. And of course, you know, very few people at this moment, the industry is so shaken that very few people are really coming forward to bring it back to its normal state. And I must say that, you know, what St. Agnelo's VCNT is doing is phenomenal. To give us this opportunity to talk, have a dialogue around this topic and other topics. So, Agnelo Rajesh, please come and join me. He's a fabulous speaker. I've had the opportunity to interact with him in the last panel discussion. Good to have you back. Okay, so I'm going to actually, can I not be the moderator today, Anuj? I would just like to hear these gentlemen in detail and be there. Somebody else, Nagu, do you want to moderate? I want to hear them. No, but really, so Anuj, oh my God, I don't know where to begin. I don't know what to make of this industry. I'm wondering, what have I done coming to real estate? Sanjay Dutt, tell me, what have I done? Anand, Rajesh, tell me. I mean, there's so much churn happening, Anuj, so much churn. It's like a whirlpool. All for the good, I know that, but right now, fairly painful period, isn't it?
It is true, Manisha, what you're saying is, I think it is once in a lifetime that any industry would have gone through a churn the way that we are going through. And you're absolutely right, the excitement, you know, which comes through the way that, you know, you're positioned at the beginning of this session is very evident in the sector as well. And that excitement is coming in from, you know, perhaps three tsunamis coming together, from demonetization to GST to RERA. To an exciting phase that it is going to be a much more mature, transparent, corporate governance market, which is going to consolidate with various stakeholders, whether it's developers or brokers or financiers. Clearly, we've not seen this. I mean, I've been in the sector for 25 years. There is no way that anything like this, either Sanjay or I, would have ever seen remotely close to what we are going through at this moment in time. So clearly a fantastic period. Lots of things that have happened. And Manisha, we're not so sure that there are many learnings from mature markets that we can bring in here. So that is also becoming even more exciting, that this is not a cycle that we are going through, that we can say, oh, this happened in a market like Singapore, and it went through a nascent market to a more transparent and a mature market, and that is what we're going to go through. I think we're just behaving very differently, maybe because we are Indians, we are behaving differently. So I think as we go through this panel discussion, you know, I'll give out some of the statistics and data, and you know, it would be very exciting and interesting to understand how the market really at a grassroots level is behaving. And I'll give you one quick statistics. You know, we were selling a development in Bombay. 10 days, 400 apartments sold.
Wow.
And Bombay.
I cannot believe that.
Exactly.
Now, these are the kind of statistics you need to tell us more. Because all that we read is nothing selling. So it's fantastic to hear this.
And I am on media. So I mean, it's not even that I'm just making it up. 10 days, 400 apartments sold. We're actually booked advertisements through the various weeks. Yesterday, we had to put in an ad to say, thank you very much. We sold out.
Wow.
And that is what is really happening in terms of the churn of the data. I'll sort of let Rajesh and Anant come in, and then I want to give a couple of more statistics.
Couple of more examples. All right, so we've started this on a good note. Agnello, Rajesh, maybe you should have a offline discussion with Anuj Puri and
his team. It's already decided in my mind.
No, but honestly, I mean, you know, you're entering the Hyderabad market. I've just met Hyderabad buyers, and of course, now the market seems to be divided between, I really don't see any problem happening for new projects. And fortunately, you come in at a time with great credentials, already RERA compliant. I think the trust has to be brought back into the market amongst buyers who are stuck in certain projects which haven't been developed. My question to you is, RERA per se, will it achieve it, or we have to go beyond RERA to give those buyers some sort of outcome or positive outcome in stuck projects?
Well, Manisha, thanks. That was a really nice opening by Anuj, very motivating. 400 units is fantastic. We launched affordable villas in Jadcharla. Before we launched, we sold 58 villas.
Okay.
So real estate is really becoming real now. The advantage today because of RERA is, it is no more the question of trust only. Mm. The developers don't have a choice. They have to be law compliant.
Right.
And the advantage is the funds of the buyers are going to be now monitored and controlled by the government. It cannot be a better situation. In fact, like I said, real estate is really becoming real. And post the independence of India, this is for the first time that a real estate buyer is going to be totally protected by the government of India.
Mm.
This has instilled a great deal of confidence in the buying. So a lot of buying pattern has improved. All the developers who are going to be RERA compliant are going to be distinguished against the people who are not complying still with the laws, especially in a state like Maharashtra, where still a lot of people are yet to be registered. So RERA is going to be the barometer for the success of an individual developer, and the buyers are going to drive the market, unlike the developers who were driving it before this. So this is absolutely going to be buyer-driven market, not just because of the reason that they are buying into the real estate, but because of the reason that now they will be able to demand their rights in terms of delivery time, in terms of the price, in terms of the size, in terms of the quality, and the government is going to be backing them up like nobody's business. Like I always said, what SEBI did to the stock market, that is exactly what RERA is doing to the real estate market. And this has excited not only Indians living in the country, but also the non-resident Indians have started reinvesting themselves again into India, because now they for sure know which date they are going to be delivered the investment that they have made for.
Absolutely.
So these are exciting times.
The exciting times. Anand Reddy, tell me, for all good developers, nothing could have been better than RERA, right? Automatically separates the wheat from the chaff.
Yes.
Are the buyers beginning to come back? I mean, in your state, in your city, are they beginning to come back? Because the rules got notified pretty late.
Yes.
That's the
yes.
only problem. Or are they still waiting to have an authority up there, a website, working website up there? What's really going on?
No, Manisha, one thing, what happened with the RERA is that it has given the vindictiveness of the developers who have been already regulated.
Correct.
So it was a clustered market in an enormous sector. It was becoming very difficult to know who was the organized and who was not organized, who was regulated, who was not regulated. One fantastic thing happened with the RERA is that now you can distinguish between who is organized and who is not organized.
Correct.
So there's a clarity has been established for the buyers now with whom they can buy. So there can be a pre-RERA, post-RERA projects. So coming to the infrastructure that needs to be provided by authority, obviously, I mean, it's a long process, but we have a 3 months of window for to register with the RERA authority. And by that time, I believe the government is going to set up the infrastructure in place, because MahaRERA has already established a kind of a process and pattern, and I understand it's a TCS which has developed the information system. I understand government is in talks with them. So very soon we're going to see that infrastructure also in place.
All right. You know, the source code was shared, Anuj. I am going to play the devil's advocate here. The central ministry actually shared the source code with states off the website and said, go ahead, take this and develop it. Yet it's taken so much time. I just wish, and don't you also, that they had met the timelines, because the delay has caused not just the buyers, it's costing the industry more. Look at the launches. They've fallen to probably an all-time low.
So you're absolutely right. Yeah, absolutely right, Manisha. And, it is It is very frustrating that you know, this law was in the making for a very long time, and the central government had made it very clear that you know, that it starts applicability on 1st of May, and before 31st of July, all the projects need to be registered. And beyond 31st of July, they would not allow marketing of any project which is not going to be registered. So it was evident and it was very clear that they were not wanting to dilute this messaging and the time period. I 100% endorse your statement that it is frustrating that why the state governments were not able to deliver this. Maharashtra did. Several others were able to deliver it. There was no rocket science in that is. And why did they actually take so much time? And the trouble today is not of the buyer, but really, you know, for someone like an Anand Reddy, who's a developer, how does he go out and today sell if he cannot register his project on RERA because the sites are not yet up in many of these states? I do want to sort of take a step back and give you two more data points, and which are related to the question that you asked. You know, after RERA, our thought is that the premium which a good developer charged over not so good developer is actually going to reduce.
Hugely. Because of the transparency.
Exactly.
And I wouldn't even say it's good versus not good. It's just that the large corporates, the brands which had early entry and became big names, Sanoj, always commanded a premium, and the new players found it harder to get there, right? Even though in NCR and other markets, we found that new players actually were delivering better. In many cases, new players were delivering better. So that's actually a good equalizer.
Absolutely. So we think is that, you know, traditionally they were able to charge between 10 to 25%. Premium over the other developers. Now that premium is going to actually go down to 5 to 10%. There may be still a premium, but that premium has gone down to 5 to 10%. The other data point on the launches I want to give is where you touch base is that, and this is a very interesting data point, and this gives me a huge amount of enthusiasm that the market does seem to be coming back, is that over the last six quarters, consecutively over the last six quarters, the new launches have been lesser than the sales. Each of those six quarters, sales has been higher than the new launches, which really means is whatever the unsold inventory was there, the overhang of unsold inventory has started to come down. And this is six quarters consecutively. The only other time that we saw this was in 2011. So after 6 years, we're starting to see some signs of revival in the sector, because, you know, just the law of economics says is that when the supply and demand start to meet and the demand starts to go up, the prices and the enthusiasm and the momentum in the market picks up. I think we're getting onto that cusp. Would we reach there in 9 months, 12 months, 18 months? I think it's somewhere between 12 to 18 months that we will reach when the cycle will really take its full momentum. But it has, the data is starting to indicate that the sales is now more than what the launches is. And I'm not saying that because the buyer has suddenly zoomed and there is a huge amount of demand. It is, to Manisha's point, is that the launches have gone down dramatically. But in a way, it is helping the market because the unsold inventory is starting to come down.
Correct. Is there, you know, when we take that 12 to 18 months period of when the excess inventory will get soaked up, but there will be micro markets which would probably not have the right kind of inventory. So it's very hard to actually generalize for an entire country, isn't it?
And that is absolutely correct. There will be micro markets where you're going to see still a huge amount of overhang of inventory despite...
I work out of that micro market.
you know, fortunately, we're doing this show in Hyderabad. Not from where Manisha lives, so we can, I think, talk a little bit more liberally of that market. So, you know, Manisha is based out of Delhi, and clearly, you know, there is a huge amount of overhang of inventory in Gurgaon and Noida. The launches have certainly gone down, and as a result of which, over a period of time, you know, you're going to see the unsold inventory coming down. But I think that market will take longer than some of the other micro markets to recover. I certainly feel as this market is a fantastic market, Hyderabad, compared to many others. You know, people sitting in here may not agree. You probably don't agree because you've not seen the other markets. We've seen those markets, and we can tell you is that you are in one of the better markets in the country. There is still economic activity, growth, employment. You have very strong political leadership who's able to bring in a lot of business in here, and employment generation continues to remain a very strong benefit for this state, which does result in a huge amount of demand for the housing, which some of the other states are not enjoying at this moment in time.
I know, speed of decision, and it's great to have Telangana and Andhra Pradesh compete, isn't it? It benefits everybody. Angela Rajesh, what do you say? How did you decide to come to Hyderabad? I mean, what was your decision making on Hyderabad?
Well, I accidentally landed on the Hyderabad airport. I missed a flight and this was a transit point. When I saw the airport, I was so stunned and surprised and happy that Hyderabad really looks exciting. On the second visit, I already had picked up a project, and we found a very good partner in my friend Pradeep Mangati from Hyderabad, and we decided to do this. I would like to also add, Manisha, that the jugaad system in the real estate industry is over, done and over with.
Fantastic.
There is no
jugaad. Can we give a big round of applause for that? I mean, high time, right?
The jugaad system is over. It is now going to be
people's largest chunk of life savings.
Yes, yes, yes. So there was a time when the developer used to start thinking about a project and start selling it. He had not even procured the land and used to start selling it. Then he used to print the brochure and start selling it. The land was still not identified. The project was still not defined and he was still selling it. The jugaad days are over. Now it is the reality market. It is a complete reality show in the real terms. And today, before you launch, because of RERA, you need to have all your patrikas in place. There has to be title certificate. There has to be character certificate of the developer, which has to be uploaded. Everything has to be in place. All permissions in hands, in the pockets. The site needs to be activated, and then he's permitted by the RERA to launch the project. So it is a fantastic scenario, and this thing is really going to add magic to the country. We all know real estate is the biggest driver of this country, along with the automobile industry. It also employs and churns a lot of capital, which adds to the growth of the country, any country, including a developing country, one of the fastest developing country, which is India. So I think this change of situation will definitely help. It is more buyer driven than developer driven. At the same time, the margins in the real estate industry have really going to be reduced dramatically. It's the buyer benefit market now. Your profits are going to be as if you run a factory. In a factory, you can't make abnormal profits. So the abnormal profit days of the real estate industry are gone. Only the serious players who are well educated, not only by qualification, but who are well educated by the industry, by the know-how, who has got hands-on experience, who can put the right things to place and create a product with nominal profits. Even 15 to 20% tomorrow is going to be considered a phenomenal profitable project, which the real estate industry was never used to pre-RERA regime. Now this is going to be real good news. Volume is going to be the name of the game. Price and size of the units is going to be the name of the game. And the amenities, the facilities, the services is also going to be the name of the game. Today, when you make a promise on the brochure, the government is really going to look at it with a very strong telescopic eyes. Everything you print on the brochure has to be delivered. So builders have also stopped putting models, pictures in the brochures. The customer might demand the model then, along with the house. So these are really going to be exciting times. It has become a very serious industry. Nobody can take a customer for a ride. And if the builder makes a mistake, then he's going to be really dancing to the tunes of the buyers. He's going to really take them to the RERA departments, and it's going to be a circus of sorts. So I think this is fantastic what's happening at the moment.
Developers dancing to the tunes of the buyers. Oh my God, I would love to really shoot
it's
that.
It's already happening. It's already happening.
It is
today. The developer is not praying to his deity. He's praying to his customer that please don't get angry or disappointed with me. Today he's selecting the customer as if he's selecting a wife for a marriage. Because if he's a nuisance customer, tomorrow he's going to harass the life out of him. So it's really changed times. We're going to enjoy this process.
Absolutely. All right. So, Anand, you have anything to add on just RERA? And the confidence is definitely there. We do, at least in Maharashtra, which has a working website, everything there. We actually went out, our reporters went out to speak to buyers who've been waiting on the sidelines to say, can they now come back? And you know, interesting things we heard back from them. One of the buyers says, now I know. Now the sales team cannot tell me that 80 units are sold. I can see on the RERA website, only 23 are sold. So you know the kind of feedback, what are they seeing? We thought they're going to look at the amount which has moved into the escrows, or they're going to look at carpet area. The first thing that they say is, we know we are being told the right thing by the salesperson. I mean, just look at the buyer psychology, Anand.
Yeah.
How he's just feeling so empowered for the first time.
Then you will have a sympathy on the developer, what he's going through. See, putting aside the 70% of money on the project, then he knows that he's not making any money, so let me not extract him much more than what I'm expecting out.
Yeah.
So see, it's a win-win for both the sides. As I said earlier, I mean, for the regulated developers, not much of difference it's making because all the systems are in place. All they have to get is registered with the authority. And since the funds are already there, the bankers are already there.
For all organized developers, there's really, like, it's just falling into the procedure.
Exactly.
Right?
So 90% of the developers in Hyderabad fall in that category.
90%.
So even if you look at even the buyer, even the banker doesn't release the money until the construction is progressed. So there is no way that the buyer, the developer has a chance to divert or do anything. So some of these points has been already plugged in over the years. So RERA was only the last mile in the race. So I think, I mean, it should not make a big difference, but obviously it gives a lot of confidence to the buyer. As I said, it's a general feeling to know what's happening in the developer side, but on our side in Hyderabad, the kind of prices we are selling at, we feel that the buyer is going to have more sympathy towards the developer than the other way around.
In fact, I don't know about the sympathies right now. Even the 10% buyers who are stuck, I had only one thing to tell them. I said, look, forget about what rules are. Remember one thing, if it's not a RERA registered project, that developer will not be able to sell any inventory. So he or she will come to his knees and want to register, whether RERA rules ask him to register or not. I mean, Telangana rules say that before any project, before 1st January 2017, does not fall under RERA ambit, but I don't think that will stand for very long. All right, let's move to GST.
I think, I mean, it also created an opportunity for the real estate brokerage companies.
Yes.
So this was the one area where we were lacking a very organized real estate brokerage companies. So RERA coming in is actually helping us to getting a professional brokerage companies, because earlier we had like a professional construction companies, professional architects, but we were lacking a professional brokerage companies. So obviously that's one of the reasons why Anuj has actually moved from the...
Absolutely. Why would Anuj otherwise
created an opportunity
to set up Anarok?
Exactly. So now, I mean, when we launch a new project, obviously, like, we outsource the contracting, we outsource the other services. Now we'll be looking at outsourcing our sales and marketing also, so we can focus on the delivery of the project.
Yeah.
So RERA has not only helped one sector, like all the stakeholders, like brokers, buyers, and the developers.
That's a good
well.
Point that you brought in. I mean, it's really cleaned up the industry in one go. It's been a decade of a fight of asking the central government and then the states to follow. But it's now happened, and let's keep our fingers crossed that the buyers come back sooner than later. They have, like Anuj says, the numbers are not looking bad at all for good projects and good developers. Let's move on to GST. There still remains some amount of confusion, Anuj. I'm still getting emails, and mostly these are luxury projects. These are really not affordable category project. People are writing in, taking developers' cases and said, we've got a new demand of 5 lakhs, 6 lakhs. What's going on? I mean, GST was meant to be tax neutral. But it seems that in luxury properties or expensive properties, again, this is no new properties, there's no issue. New projects, there's no issue. But we also have to resolve the dilemma that buyers who are already in projects are facing.
Yeah, and it's a very important point. Maybe not as much of consequence as RERA.
Of course.
You know, a different consequence, because if you look at it in totality, and we take the macro picture, Manisha, as you said, there's new projects, no problem, because they know that they're entering the agreement and they have to pay 12% GST or a net of whatever the credit is. The completed projects, again, no problem, because after occupation certificate, GST is not applicable, so that goes out.
Right.
It's really in between the projects. What we are finding is a solution, what the developers are being able to come to terms is, that GST is 18%. Don't say, no, it's not, it's 12%. It's 18% minus one third, which is towards the land.
Land cost.
And
land
so that is where it comes to 12%. Now in luxury and premium projects, just like in Bombay, you know, land is not one third of the project. The land is probably 60, 70, 80% of the project. And that's where you're finding that the developer has been hit hard, because he's getting or she's getting only a third as an offset, whilst there is a huge proportion of the land component that has gone in on which they have to pay. But I think they're taking a macro picture, and what they're saying is it's 12%. So for example, in Maharashtra, 5.5% is what the buyers were paying. 12% is what the new GST is. If you take the credit inputs, you'll probably get 3.5%, 4.5%. So it would have come down to about 8%. 5.5% they were anyway paying, so the delta is only 2.5%. Majority of the developers are saying, we will absorb it as 2.5%. Let's not confuse the buyer, because the buyer, you know, is confused enough. This is one point that we do not think that we want a confusion to be done. If the buyer is ready, most of these advertisements you will find is where they're saying we are absorbing the GST. So that let the cycle start to move on. And that's where I think is that the buyer media
has been caught up. Should not all developers be doing it, Anuj? Because already there's, I mean, that's the segment which is hit the most as well, luxury, right? My worry is that every time a buyer writes into us with a GST charge which has been levied, it just kind of shakes his confidence. He gets multiple opinions from chartered accountants, Agnilu Rajesh, and you know, some chartered accountants will say, look, yes, the developer's on the right. Another chartered accountant will turn around and say, look, he's not, he's using certain clauses to his advantage. So there's a bit of confusion. I think industry should just take it on its chin, no? On GST?
Well,
just a few projects.
Absolutely. What I have seen as an entrepreneur is, any taxation is welcome. It's going to make you very uncomfortable. You have to digest it, absorb, live it, and outlive it. It's as simple as that. GST, of course, has made the purchasing a little expensive, but the developer has readjusted his price because he's more concerned about the balance 72% or 78% rather than that, or 82%, 88% rather than that 12%, 18% circus. What GST has although done, it has simplified the taxation process. It has simplified how a development company can work at the peace of mind with only one GST to be worried about, instead of having 10 different varieties of taxes sitting on their heads. Any regulation will make the product expensive. Some portion the client will absorb, some portion the developer or the supplier in any business model would absorb. Bringing clarity itself is a great relief. We talk about offset and your input cost gets adjusted and all of that. Actually, that is not the sales point, sales price driving point. What is sales point driving point for any developer is, at what price will his stock get sold in the real practical market?
Correct.
He is ready to absorb 2.5%, he is ready to absorb 18%, he is also ready to absorb and sell at cost. It all depends on the situation that developer is at. And it all depends on how much unsold inventory is there on his palms. So it's a situational decision rather than an ad hoc format of how a developer will now react. Every developer is wearing a different shoe, different brand, different size. So he needs to adapt to his situation. So I don't see, as a practical developer, I will try to rate it, whether I have to absorb it, not absorb it. It is more of a supply and demand situation, which is helping me to understand how to get the GST into my system. So I think it is difficult. It is pinching the developer. It is pinching the buyer. But ultimately, it is going to be market-driven and decision-based on the situation.
And it's a short-term, very, very short-term adjustment. All right, gentlemen, my final question to each one of you. Why do you want to do real estate business from here on? Give me one compelling reason, Anand, why you still want to do real estate. Because I want to continue to do real estate journalism.
No, it's a fantastic, I mean, it's a fantastic industry to be in, Manisha. It's a non-perishable business.
Non-perishable business. That's a good answer.
As long as you can hold the inventory, as long as you can be transparent, which now RERA and GST and everything is going to help. And as long as you understand that it is a service industry and you understand it is a consumer related, you're fantastic in this business.
Okay. Agnilu Rajesh.
Well, it is one of the most challenging sectors today in the country. And
because you have multiple businesses.
Oh, we are serial entrepreneurs. We are serial entrepreneurs. We brought computer education within the reach of a common man in a competitive city like Mumbai. We want to make houses very economical, very affordable, without compromising on the luxury element of it. We want to change the rules of the game. We want to be the best in the country in terms of quality, style, design, size, price, delivery time, all of it. And it is so exciting because challenge excites me as an entrepreneur. Since this is the most challenging industry, you'll be seeing a lot of me and my company, my partners across the country. And we are in a couple of cities already. Within 1.5 to 2 years, we'll be operative in 50 cities at the same time. We will change the rule of the game. We will make sure that the customer, when he buys, he's actually feeling the thought that he's bought gold at the price of silver. So this keeps me excited.
Wow.
We want to be a part of the vision and the mission of our Honorable Prime Minister Shri Narendra Modi, who wants to make sure that there is a very comfortable roof above the head of every Indian. That's a huge industry. And house is something, if you don't build a church or a temple or a mosque, is fine. But if you develop homes for people, that is a place where they pray, they live, and they stay together. The blessings that we are getting for the kind of work we do is so enormous that I don't think any other industry will give us this kind of respect that we are receiving from our customers today. So we love real estate, we love developing homes, and we aim to be the best in the industry in the coming years in this country of India.
Can we get this entire thing transcribed and put it up on the homepage of nw18.com? All right. Leaving it last for Anuj, 25 years, Anuj, you've completely changed the boots, the suit and the hat that you're wearing, right? So tell me, now buyers, you're on the buyer's side, or you're selling to buyers, and you were earlier only meeting these gentlemen.
And it is a very different business, Manisha. I mean, I've always been a B2B and it's a B2C. I said it to someone this morning that, you know, I'm interviewing and we're hiring. We're about 1,000 people now. You know, I used to hire people who would wear white shirt and tie and black suits. I hire now people who are wearing yellow shirt, green tie, brown suits.
Yes.
So they're a lot more charismatic. You know, we work Saturday, Sundays. I've never worked in my life Saturday, Sunday. This business has taught me to work Saturday, Sunday. Wednesdays are weekly off. So there's a huge amount of learning after 25 years on running a B2C business. Lots of challenges, lots of excitement. But clearly, if RERA wasn't there, or we were not being able to put a digital platform, it would have been difficult for me to compete in this business. I think you're going to see this industry, as Anand said, is that there will be a huge amount of consolidation, cleansing. You're going to see the fly-by-night operators in the intermediary space as well go away. This is a licensed business now.
First time.
And, you know, first time licensed business. Clearly, we're seeing the benefits of that coming in. And through the digital platform, I do feel is that you'll be able to corporatize and institutionalize a B2C platform.
Trust Anuj, isn't it, Sanjay? Trust him to move, be the first mover in the biggest opportunity in real estate. Gentlemen, thank you very much for joining me. It's been a very engaging and a really interesting conversation, I must say.
That was awesome. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Manisha.
Please stand here. Please be here. Lakshmi, my colleague, would like to present you with certificates for participation and for really honored to have all of you here. And of course, thank you for making the time.
Hi, Lakshmi. Thank you
thank
for having
you
us here.
Thank you very much. Fantastic session,
thank
as
you.
Always.
I would like to invite Lakshmi Potluri, Chief of Staff, Network 18 Digital, to hand over token of appreciation to our panelists.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Manisha.
Thank you.
As always, beautiful, wonderful.
I'm just finding it a showpiece.